This is an opportunity now to ask some questions of both Greg and Heather and maybe explore this topic a little bit further. It's very complex, and I think each of us need a little help in really understanding all the complexities. First questions?
Hi, thank you for holding this forum today. This is great. I learned more in 40 minutes about a 50-year history of election law than I thought was possible. And Heather, towards the end of what you were saying, you did mention quite a few things that are happening right here in New Jersey and what your center is doing at the state and local levels. How can people like myself, people in this church, how can we get involved? If we're not lawyers, we're not specialists of any sort, what can we really practically do to help?
That's a great question. The first thing is go to thecitizenscampaign.com to learn how you can get involved in your community. We really stress that you can't point the finger at government officials, but point the finger at yourself and what are you doing to fix the system. In your hometown, you can see if your town has a pay-to-play ordinance. If not, present it to your local governing body, your school board, make sure they have a good restrictions in place, and even your county party. That's one step. If you want to influence political parties and how they're raising money and spending money, you can actually get involved in the political parties. You have a right to run for a county committee seat and get involved in your local political party and have a say in how they spend money. Parties have an extraordinary advantage here in New Jersey in influencing the election system. The county political party can spend up to $35,000 a single contribution of $35,000 from one person, whereas the state party is $25,000. So it's really, the system is rigged in favor of the county parties, and then they can spend unlimited funds to candidates wherever. So really, it's getting involved in your local town, and if you're willing to take that next step, seize the power within the political party, get on your county committee, which is a very easily attainable position, and start trying to be a voice of reason within the system and try to say, hey, wait, let's do this the honorable way. And also, you know, support candidates, make it easier for them. Campaign contributions aren't dirty, inherently dirty. We should, you know, support candidates that share your values and show that that can be done. You know, a big criticism that we get is, well, if you limit pay to play, no one's going to be able to run. It's only going to be millionaires. And I haven't seen millionaires taking over the state of New Jersey in local town councils, so I don't really believe that one is true. But, you know, support candidates. Make a contribution that if you believe in the candidate.
Yeah, I'd like to chime in on that. I believe that the great majority of us don't make contributions. It's maybe, you know, we talk about 99.1%. Well, I don't know. But most of us, most persons have not made any contributions. As a matter of fact, one of the advantages I had of working with ELA, if I was ever approached for a political contribution, I could say, I'm terribly sorry. I can't say that anymore, and let me just say this about small contributions. I mean, big money and all of that and the potential to influence candidates is very real, and it's a great problem. But there's nothing like small contributions, absolutely nothing like small contributions. And the reason I say that is because people who actually dig into their wallet and make a contribution to a candidate are investors. They are invested in a good outcome. And an outcome they want, and they're going to go vote. Now, I haven't done any survey, I haven't seen any studies on this, but my gut feeling is that people who make contributions to candidates actually end up voting for them, much more than others. And this is one of the big problems with self-finance candidates, and it's one of the big problems with public financing, to be very frank, which is that a publicly financed candidate can't accept contributions except for legal and accounting expenses and federally. And I think that's a big problem, because people who make contributions are committed to you. And so if you talk about one thing you can do, make a contribution yourself, and after you do that, talk to your neighbors and friends about making contributions to, you know, a candidate you favor. And because those neighbors and friends, if they do decide to do that, they will be committed to actually go out and vote and participate in the system. And I think that's the healthiest thing. Finally, one more thing to say about that. If I were king of the world, I would pass a law that provided a tax relief for people, for individuals who make small political contributions. And I can't understand why that doesn't happen. I'll be honest. I really don't. I think that's one reform, simple, straightforward. Give everybody a tax deduction for a small, you know, whatever it is, a small individual, not corporations, not anybody else, but individuals. So that seems to make a lot of sense to me, and I think it would encourage a wider participation, and certainly it would enable candidates to get their own message out and not be so vulnerable to, you know, the super PACs.
Hi, my name is Carol Allen, and I am a member of a National Unitarian Universalist organization called UUs for a Just Economic Community, and we have been writing and presenting workshops on corporate personhood for 25 years. So the question I'm going to ask right now may be a bit of a rhetorical question, but do you speakers and Reverend Hirschberg, do you not feel that the Citizens United decision is a real threat to democracy in that corporations exist for the purpose of making money? They are required by law to make money on behalf of their stockholders. They do not exist to promote the general welfare. And our concepts of democracy was that people would go to the polls to choose people who would promote some concept of a general welfare, of a good society.
I think that the premise of Citizens United, that independent expenditures have absolutely no potential corrupting influence, is questionable. I think it is questionable. For example, even the threat of making independent expenditures is a serious one to a candidate. I mean, imagine if I represent a big company and I go to a candidate and I say something along the lines of, you know what, if you vote this way, I can promise you that we will fund a big independent expenditure campaign. I mean, I think that would be potentially coordination, but even if it's not, just a threat. And they don't even have to spend the money. Just a threat is enough to make, I think, an office holder think twice about, you know, their voting. So, on the other hand, I do agree that we need to hear from corporations. We do need to hear from them. They do represent an important part of our economy. The dissent says they have a voice through their PACs. Maybe one of the things we could do, what is really, really troubling to me, is not only are they participating, but they can do it anonymously now. We've lost disclosure. So the first step, it seems to me, is we've got to get disclosure back. And there's a legislation in the Disclose 2012 Act, which I think is worth supporting, because it will take the Russian doll effect, what they call the Russian doll. You know, when you buy these things and you open it up and there's another doll inside and there are more and more and more. And that's what happens with passing money around and using the C4s and everything else. And it would address the transferring of funds. And I think disclosure is right now terribly compromised, especially from corporate activity. And as far as corporate activity is concerned, I think maybe we have to take another look at PACs. We have to take another look at what they can do, maybe, or find some way to creatively funnel money that represents corporate interests. I don't know what all the answers are, but so I think the basic premise, however, get back to your question, the basic premise that independent expenditures do not have the potential of corrupting office holders is questionable. I do think that.
I think we don't really have a position on the corporate personhood issue, but I think what's important here is having a strong media to cover these expenditures and how these companies are spending money. We've had cases here in New Jersey where specific interest groups give contributions right around the time that a bill is going through the legislature, and then all of a sudden, oh, it passed. All these legislators were in support, and that made you question, was this done in the interest of the lobby group that made the large campaign contributions, or is it generally good for the public? And usually it's the press and a strong press that can vet and look at the issue and inform the public. And I think that's something that's been eroding here in New Jersey. There's less media coverage at state level and the local level. And as much as we can, try to, you know, buy your local newspaper, stay informed on the issues, and keep your neighbors informed. Hopefully that can, you know, push back a little bit on the corrupting influence that these contributions may have. It's having someone intelligently look at, you know, how is this money impacting the process?
I was just going to say that I'm not a lawyer, but I question whether we've really looked at the fact that there is an unequal access to the marketplace media created by this process. And I wonder if some constitutionality issue is going on there, because it seems that folks like me cannot possibly begin to have an equal voice in the political process. So I think that's a big question to me. I don't have the answer for it.
If I could add one more thing. I think part of the solution is an article in today's New York Times. And the headline was, Obama looks to expand campaigns' reach through social media. Now, I'm not an expert in this, believe me. But the idea is he's going to use a YouTube platform to enable people to post campaign content on their Facebook pages and then share it with their friends. The internet, electronic communications offers opportunities for low-cost communication vehicles. We've seen this with the Arab Spring and so forth. So the old method of TV advertising, while still very effective, is not the only means of communication. And one of the hopes that I would have is that the freedom on the internet. Another thing that I find interesting is that Obama is so much more popular among young people than among old people. Old guys like me, we don't use the internet and YouTube and all that stuff. I'm sort of an electronic hermit. But it was incredibly effective for Obama's campaign in 2008, and obviously he's gearing up to do even more in 2012. And that's a vehicle that can help remedy the disparity in financial resources that opponents may have.
Stefano Crema, and I'm from the Morristown Unitarian Fellowship, and I have a kind of two questions. A quick one, and perhaps speaking up on the previous question. Am I correct in the understanding that eliminating the personhood of corporation wouldn't have any effect on the amount of money that is put into the electoral system? And second, do you think that really to resolve at the root the problem of money in election, we would have to go to some kind of constitutional amendment that prevents the money is speech concept?
Great. Let me take the constitutional amendment. Anybody here know the last time the Constitution was amended? I actually looked it up. It's 1991. The amendment was that Congress could not vote themselves raises during their session. That was it. Before that, it was in the 1970s. Constitutional amendment, and I'll say this too. Constitutional amendment and even campaign finance legislation do not have constituencies as such. Rarely have constituents. A case like Citizens United inspires people to get excited about it, but most people really it doesn't, you vote for somebody because of what their policies are. You don't vote for them typically because you don't hear candidates going around saying, oh, if I get elected, there's going to be campaign finance reform. I shouldn't be banging the table. There'll be campaign finance reform. So I say this, and I don't mean to be cynical or negative, but the chances of getting a constitutional amendment to this are pretty close. It seems to me at zero. The chances of getting Congress to act responsibly is tougher to assess. But I will, you know, the old saying is time and scandal are the parents of reform. And that certainly was the case in Watergate. And maybe, you know, we'll see scandals with super PACs that will, especially in the area of disclosure, which I'm very concerned about. The first question you asked was, what would be the effect of eliminating corporate money? And I think there's a metaphor I'd like to give you on that. And I think it's true. It's a very common metaphor in this field. It's that money flows downhill. You dam it in one place, and it flows through another. You know, we have to think this is a capitalistic democracy. It's unrealistic. Some people, you know, I used to, some of them are members of our congregation, used to talk to me about public financing, and they talked about it in a way in which it was like a laboratory experiment, you know, where you didn't have any polluting conditions and everything else. That's not real. That's just simply not real. In my opinion, it's not real to think that corporations that are so regulated, and not business, the business community itself that is so regulated, is not going to be concerned and want to use its resources to influence public policy. It's simply not realistic. But I think what is important is that when they use that funds, that there be disclosure and be used in a responsible way. And we can disagree or agree about, you know, what those are, but right now it does seem to be that the post Watergate reforms have really been severely compromised, and whether moving from a democracy to a plutocracy, I don't know, but I think it is a concern, and I would certainly advocate for greater participation of the public in campaigns and contributions, and also in reform of the disclosure laws. Okay.
The one thing, and I can't believe I forgot to say this before, is that few people probably realize that there is a federal pay-to-play law already on the books. It was the Hatch Act, adopted, I think, in the 1950s. I think
that's right.
Around the 1950s, yeah. And in it, it prohibits businesses getting contracts from giving to the presidential candidates, and I believe the parties. But the way around that are the PACs and the independent expenditures. So one way also to stem the influence would be expanding the current Hatch Act prohibition on businesses making contributions and extend it to the other areas that are already limited, where they're not right now.
And I believe Obama put out an executive order on pay-to-play.
He floated one around but never signed it.
He never signed it, right. Signed. Okay.
It was making its way around right. To people.
Okay. To move on to our next question.
So, this is Chris Grazioso with the Unitarian Church in Summit, New Jersey. You were just talking before about disclosure 2012, and yes. I was just trying to understand what happened with Citizens United that split out. I guess you were talking about the difference between a 527 and a C4, and that
yes.
disclosure is required in one but not in the other.
Yes.
And so, whatever made that happen, why would disclosure 2012 negate that or allow it to change?
That's a great question, and I really didn't have time to address that. That's a great question. What happened in 2007 was the Federal Election Commission had to deal with a previous Supreme Court opinion that permitted, that held that certain communication, for the electioneering communications controls of disclosure to be enforced, the communication had to be the functional equivalent of express advocacy. In other words, what it did was it took a group, in this case it was a Wisconsin Right to Life group, it took a nonprofit corporation, and it had to deal with the fact that that corporation could put funds into a campaign. It could make certain types of communications and pay for them. Well, the FEC took a step that's very controversial. The FEC went further, and unions wanted this, by the way. There was a union that advocated this, that when corporations give money, and as a matter of fact, in New Jersey, corporations can, in about half the states in this country, corporations can make direct contributions to candidates. You know who it is. If it's the ABC Corporation that makes a contribution, you don't need to know everybody who invested in it. You don't need to know everybody who's buying ABC products. You know it's the ABC Corporation. The problem is now, though, that was in 2007. In 2010, along comes this decision. And by the way, in Citizens United, the Supreme Court upheld, said disclosure is constitutional. They reiterated that. Maybe what they didn't realize is that that under this FEC rule, corporations did not have to disclose who was giving them money. And they're using C-4s because, and even if you have a corporation, it could be a shell corporation. The point is that they're using C-4s to hide, and for good reason. Corporations aren't foolish. I mean, let me put it this way. It's unlikely you're going to see an advertisement for a presidential candidate sponsored by your favorite cereal. And the reason you won't is because some of you aren't going to like that candidate and you won't buy the cereal anymore. It's that simple. So corporations are very sensitive to being identified. And resistant to it, and they've taken, and unions too. They have taken advantage of their ability to have sister corporations, shell corporations, whatever, and the use of C-4s to hide. And basically, when you see one of these negative attack ads, you and a group like Swift Boat for Veterans, you have no idea who the heck they are. Americans for Progress, who the heck are they? My favorite super PAC is the one that Stephen Colbert established, which I just love. If I'm correct, I think the name of it is For a Better America Tomorrow.
Tomorrow.
Thank you.
We've seen an unprecedented amount of money that's been raised by super PACs being used for negative campaigning. Many of the attack ads foster false statements or half-truths. Is there any way to require campaign ads to be truthful? And another part is, do libel laws apply to campaign ads? And since many of these nonprofits fold right after election, does the public have any recourse?
Okay, great. Great questions. One of my favorite cases is the Washington State Supreme Court case, which actually held that lies were constitutionally protected in campaign ads. I love that case. The hazards in trying to set up a government agency to regulate the content of political ads are enormous, the truthfulness of them. Are enormous, and of course the court is going to say that give tremendous latitude to ads and let the public judge for themselves whether how truthful they are, and that is basically the rule of political advertising. Libel laws do apply though, and there are cases, and there's been a case in New Jersey where if you libel someone, that's different. That does apply. But if you say things like, Congressman Jones voted for, a tax increase or something, and it turns out that it was a big bill for more troops in Vietnam or whatever it was, That stuff, you can't regulate. You can't regulate the truthfulness of ads. It's like hammering Jell-O on a wall. You've got to rely on the political process. But now what is very, very scary is that one side has these super PACs and a lot more resources. So that's very scary. So libel laws do apply, but there's great latitude and danger in government trying to regulate the content of political advertisement. Did I get all the question? Was that it? Was it the rest of it was what?
Is there any recourse? Does the public have any recourse to these nonprofits that do these things?
Good. Well, this is a real problem. I mentioned that the FEC fined them $300,000. Well, one thing you've suggested, well, they go out of business. I mean, you know, after the election, they've spent their money, and that's a relatively small amount compared to what they raised. A candidate that's libel has recourse in the courts, but that's rather rare. There are criminal penalties attached to intentional activity to hide money or what have you. But no is the answer. I mean, the government is extremely reluctant. Rarely do you hear of any criminal prosecution even being attempted for something like that. And it's for free speech reasons. One other thing I didn't talk about just quickly is that one of the other criticisms about letting corporations, this gentleman raised, is that we don't allow foreign nationals to make contributions to candidates. And one of the questions is, I mean, you can't assume that a corporation is owned by Americans. And is this a tremendous loophole for foreign governments to use to... Maybe one thing that will happen is we'll see so many of these attack ads that after a while the public's just going to stop listening to them. You don't know what the source of them, you're just going to start, they're going to lose credibility. Maybe that'll happen.
And there are independent nonprofits that do fact-checking. I think Center for Public Integrity might be one.
Yes.
PolitiFact does, you know, candidates and elected officials, the Truthometer that you've been seeing on the Star Ledger.
Yes, that's a very...
So there are independent groups that monitor and will vet whether or not it's truthful or not. But if they're buying lots of ad time, hopefully through the power of the Internet, the word can spread that this is... clearly false. Maybe it'll become a joke. I mean, but there's whole companies that specialize in creating good negative ads that might have the potential to go viral. It's hard to combat, but hopefully there could be more organizations that can promote when something's truthful or not.
Thank you.
Let me just say, why are independent expenditure always negative ads? Why aren't some of them positive? Well, it's a very simple reason, very logical reason. Sometimes when you endorse somebody or you're positive, it's not helpful to them, to the candidate. I'll give you an extreme example. The American Nazi Party endorses so-and-so. You know, that's not good. That's really not good. On the other hand, and especially if it's some sort of anonymous group that you don't know what it is, endorsement means nothing. Praise means nothing either. Plutocrats for so-and-so. It doesn't help. But if you really want to influence a candidate, what you do is you take his opponent, you find some chink in the armor of the opponent, and you run a negative ad. And for sure, the guy you want to influence is going to be thankful. That you can count on. If you attack his opponent, that you can count on as being, you know, influential on whoever it is you want to try to influence. That's why independent ads almost always are negative. Plus, they're very much more effective. We remember them.
My name is Cecilia Koska, and I'm from the Unitarian Universalist Church of Montclair. And I have a follow-up question on the issue of a movement for a constitutional amendment. I heard you take the view that chances are next to nil, and I think that the chances are very small. But I'd like to ask for your opinion as to the potential impact that such a movement might be able to have eventually, even if an amendment never passes. Okay, we have a lot of problems getting improvements in the disclosure laws, improvements in different types of public financing of campaigns that could possibly have some influence because of why all the resistance we're getting from the powers that be. And so I'd like to ask your opinion as to whether or not a movement, there is some impetus, it's growing for a constitutional amendment, and there's various types of amendments, but primarily they focus on either overturning the corporate personhood or changing the proposition that changing the law on money is speech. And so, what is your view on the potential impact of a growing movement like that in terms of eventually improving the laws?
To the extent that campaign finance can develop a constituency among citizens of the public, it's terrific, because that's what ultimately Congress will react to, hopefully. And that's what I said before, that time and scandal are the parents of reform. Something like Citizens United comes along, and it mobilizes people, and hopefully it will have an effect even on this Congress at some point, and they will do something to enact legislation either along the lines Heather talked about, giving the SEC powers to compel companies to clearly say when they in their annual reports or whatever how much money they've spent for political advertising, or the Disclose Act of 2012 that I talked about, which will help us find out what companies are paying for what ads, what unions are involved too. So I think it's great. To the extent that there's a constituency out there, it'll put pressure on both parties to make some reform. And I think disclosure is a very, even the people who argue that super PACs are good for the system, I don't think they argue that non-disclosure is good. So I think there'll be a lot of support for that.
I also agree that it's very valuable. I mean, if we want to see any change, it has to come from the ground up and the grassroots and citizens. And as Greg said, if you don't get the whole enchilada, you're going to get significant reforms as legislators see. Citizens are demanding change. We want change, and hopefully then we would get it. But we do need people to speak up and call for it.
My name is Mary Sherman, and I'm a Princeton resident. I think just to tag on what was just said there, the way that the abortion law has been attacked has been niggled at piece by piece by piece, and corporate personhood could probably be addressed in the same way, a little bit here, a little bit there, a little bit more, and keep going. That would probably make a difference. My question is, I think, Greg, you drew several comparisons or suggested that corporations and unions are somewhat similar, and I would like to hear your a little further on that, because it seems to me, and things to most of us, that corporations represent money, whereas unions are supposed to represent people.
Right, and campaign regulation. The history has been that corporations and unions have been regulated together. Obviously, Democrats want to see corporations regulation. Republicans want to see unions regulated, and unions have. Unions don't have the financial resources that corporations do, so that's a big concern. But what they do have, and I'm not going to speak for unions, but what is helpful, but this decision is helpful to unions too, because prior to this decision, unions could only communicate with members about who they endorsed. Now they can communicate to the general public, and they can use their manpower to go door to door. They can use their manpower to hand out pamphlets, leaflets, whatever, and they can make independent expenditures, spend money for communication tools, and use the advantage in terms of persons that they have to spread their views. So the Citizens United decision helps unions as well as corporations in that respect.
Thank you. I think I was asking you, what is the legitimate role for corporations in elections? You said you thought there was a role.
I think there is. There already is a role for corporations in the sense that they can establish PACs. They can't give money to their PACs, but they can help their key employees and their stockholders contribute to a fund, and that fund can contribute to candidates or make independent expenditures. That's what a PAC is. And that has existed since the 70s. PACs PACs have little higher contribution limits, $5,000 now, to a candidate. PACs are a good tool for corporations get out their concerns. And by the way, corporations are not monoliths. You know, one corporation may and another may disagree about some legislation, or some their views of some candidates. Same for millionaires. Millionaires are not monoliths. I mean, the Democrats have some millionaires, and Republicans have others. But I think, you know, let me put it this way: if there was a candidate out there, if there was legislation out there that would severely hurt our economy or close down job opportunities, I think we'd want to know about that before we went to the polls.
So the corporate role is somewhat similar to that of the union, and then you're going to. The role is similar to that of the union in that the union informs and solicits its members just as a corporation could do, and that's how they came to be lumped together?
Yes. Yes, it is.
Thank you. Next question.
My name is Elaine Nickham. I'm a member at the Unitarian Universalist Congregation of Princeton. If corporations can contribute, what are the full disclosure rights of their shareholders?
You know, Elaine's a friend of mine, and she's not supposed to ask any hard questions. Well, I think that's a very good question, right now I don't know if shareholders could get that information. I think that's one of the areas I think Heather suggested is that there is legislation in the topper that would require the Securities and Exchange Commission, the SEC, as opposed to the FEC, which is the Federal Election Commission, the Securities and Exchange Commission, to provide that corporations would have to put in their annual reports exactly how much they're spending for political communications. Sounds like a healthy idea to me. And maybe even who they're supporting. I don't know. I mean, that they would resist that tremendously, of course, because, as I said, you know, your favorite breakfast cereal doesn't want you to associate it with a specific party or candidate because, you know, a lot of other people are going to stop eating it. Okay. Anything you want to add to that?
No, I mean, I think the bill empowering the shareholders, again, it's almost like creating grassroots movement within the companies themselves and empowering people who have a stake in it to do something and speak out if they don't agree with it.
I think we've run out of time for questions now, and just like to summarize on what we have learned. The fact is I couldn't possibly summarize what we've learned. There's so much to it. But one thing I have learned is that we need to get involved. We need to be involved in what's happening. For being quiet to sit by and watch all this process just gets us deeper into the hole. The other thing that, you know, I think we should probably, as UULM&J, think about writing a bill that gets tax relief for small donations. I think that's a wonderful idea. which some of you may disagree. At this point, I would like to thank all of you for coming. I know some of you have traveled from many different places around the state to get here today. We're just so grateful that we had such a wonderful audience. I'd also like to thank Greg Nagy and Heather Taylor for their wonderful, wonderful input and educational content that helped us all understand this issue a lot more. I'd like to thank the Princeton congregation for hosting us today and our UULM&J staff and volunteers for helping us put this program together, and also Citizen Campaign staff and volunteers. I'd like to also thank Steve Stern for our technical support. Without him, we wouldn't have known how to do this, and we want to thank him very much for that. Just a reminder that this program is our first video and an educational program of the Unitarian Universalist Legislative Ministry, the 501c3. If you are interested in getting more information, please check our website, www.uulmnj.org. That will be on the slide. We will have this link posted and also a study guide to go with it. We hope that you will take this out into your congregations, your living rooms, your neighborhoods, wherever you can, to help spread the word and help people become more involved. Thank you very much.